Thank you all for being here and welcome to this Muhammad Aquifer Community Meeting. My name is Claudia Lenhoff and I'm the Executive Director of the Champaign County Healthcare Consumers. Our organization has been helping to lead the organizing efforts here in Champaign County to protect the Muhammad Aquifer, and we have helped to convene this meeting. I will be the moderator for today's meeting. So I'm the person who's in charge of keeping us on track, keeping us on time, and so you'll be seeing me in that role. Today's meeting is brought to you by the 19 co-sponsors listed at the bottom of your green agenda. To save time, I won't read the list of who they are, but their co-sponsorship makes it possible for us to hold this meeting and provide you with informational materials. Refreshments are provided by the City of Champaign. Also, I want everybody to know that the City of Champaign is video recording this meeting and will play it on their cable channel at a later date to help get information further out to the community. Before I give you an overview of today's meeting, let me take care of some housekeeping details. If you have cell phones, please turn them off or turn off the ringers. Second, the restrooms are out the door and to the right, and please feel free to get up whenever you need to. Third, we do have refreshments, and you should feel free to get up and help yourself to those refreshments whenever you need those. Now, for the overview of today's meeting. We are holding this meeting to provide education about the Muhammad Aquifer and the ongoing efforts to protect the aquifer from toxic contamination, especially as they focus on Clinton Landfill in DeWitt County. We want to invite community members to get involved in the efforts to provide long-term protection for the Muhammad Aquifer. Protecting the aquifer is of greatest importance because the aquifer is the only source of water for more than 14 counties in central Illinois. When you turn on your faucet, you are getting water from the Muhammad Aquifer. If you drink water that's provided at the refreshment table, that is water from the Muhammad Aquifer. Over the past year, we have made important strides in our efforts to protect the aquifer, but our work is not complete and there is still more to do. The victories of the past year have only been achieved because of collective efforts involving local government, citizen groups, and state legislators. We need to build on our successes by changing state laws and regulations that govern landfills and toxic waste and that recognize the importance of sole source aquifer. Today's meeting is a means by which the public can learn more. Not all, but more, about ongoing threats to the aquifer and long-term solutions that will keep the aquifer safe and clean for generations to come. Various presenters will bring information and outlooks that illustrate the complexity of the situation. Try not to be overwhelmed by that complexity, but listen, consider, ask questions, and figure out how you want to be involved. Now, I want to say a quick word about the consent decree involving the local government coalition and the Clinton landfill that has been in the news so much lately. The plan was not to address the consent decree today at this meeting. That would require a whole meeting of its own. This meeting and its agenda was planned before the consent decree came to the forefront as a public issue and was being discussed. So there are many public proceedings regarding the consent decree that community members can participate in and learn from. But even though it is not a topic for today's meeting, we are joined by two attorneys who have been working on the consent decree. They are Joe Hooker and Dave Wentworth, who are sitting over there. And if questions about the consent decree arise, they will be able to speak to those. Now, I want to say something about a handout that is on your seats. This handout, Troubled Waters, about the consent decree. This is in opposition to the consent decree. Those of us who organized this meeting, including the folks who put out this handout, had an agreement that we were not going to be putting out material about the consent decree. So I'm not happy to see this here because it's a little bit of a violation of the terms of our meeting. But as a counterpoint then, there is another handout about the consent decree from Joe Hooker that addresses issues and questions raised in this one. So if you get this one and you want to see the official position, you can ask Joe Hooker for a copy of this. Now I want to tell you about how we're running the meeting so you all know what to expect. First of all, everyone should have an agenda packet. Your packet includes the agenda, which is this green handout, a handout on the Mahomet Aquifer, just so you can take home a copy of the map and a little bit of information about the aquifer. Another handout about long-term strategies, and Steve Carter will discuss these. And then a Get Involved form that I will talk to you about later on. The agenda, this green handout, tells you the order of presentations. This is our roadmap for this meeting. I will introduce each speaker, and we are asking all speakers to keep to their time limits. We have to end our meeting on time, right around 12:30. There is another group who will use this room after us, so we need to be respectful of that. To help us stay on time, we ask that you please hold your questions and comments until the Q&A session in the second half of the meeting, which is scheduled to last about 25 minutes. And I see I have 1 minute left. We'll have a timekeeper here, Susan, and that's a reminder that I will run a very tight program. And the last thing I wanted to say is for folks who want to stick around afterwards and have discussion, the Sierra Club Prairie Group has reserved a room upstairs, room 215, where people can go and have informal discussion. So that's the overview, and now I'd like to invite Steve Bridges of the Mahomet Aquifer Protection Alliance to come up for his presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Claudia. Like you said, I'm Steve Bridges with the Mahomet Aquifer Protection Alliance. We're a group that was formed in direct response to the threat from the chemical waste unit at Clinton Landfill. And as you can see, the Mahomet Aquifer stretches pretty much clear across central Illinois. It starts over near the Indiana border and basically exits at the Illinois River. And the aquifer is a precious resource. We are so fortunate in Illinois to have such a resource. An aquifer like this is real rare in our country, let alone our state. And some of the comments have been made about the Illinois, or about the Mahomet Aquifer and its purity. It says that it surpasses almost any water source in Illinois and beyond. And to find clear water, you have to melt ice from within a glacier. So this water is not only plentiful, but it's very pure, and we should do everything we can to protect it. I'll go real quickly. I'm going to be talking about the chemical waste unit, and I have to go through 13 years and 15 minutes, so this is going to go really fast. It all started in 2002. The DeWitt County Board was approached, and Clinton Landfill wanted to build a new landfill. And the first thing you have to do is get local siting. And that's covered by, in the Illinois Environmental Protection Act under 39.2. It says that you have to have an application, a lot of paperwork. There's also a public hearing that has to occur where the public has a chance to question the folks at the landfill. And this did happen. There was a pollution control site hearing. I hope you can see that. I don't know, that looks awful faded here. But basically, they're talking about the operating plan. Operating plan is one of the key pieces of a application for a landfill. And in the operation plan, it describes not only how the landfill is going to be constructed, but what is going to be going into the landfill. And so in this operating plan, it's also important because this becomes your link between your local siting and the state permit that gets issued later. As was part of the hearing transcripts here, Mr. Ron Edwards, who is the vice president of development of the landfill, said the operating plan becomes a part of the facility permit issued by the Illinois EPA. So this is how the Illinois EPA knows what the local siting was all about. And in this local siting, during the hearing, the landfill promised the county that waste containing PCBs regulated by the Toxic Substances Control Act will not be accepted. So if you hear people talk about TSCA, this is what they're talking about. It's a federal permit that's given out for the higher levels of PCB waste. And then also, it also says under spatial waste. Now, the terminology in landfills is very complex and doesn't always mean what it says. But this PCB waste and the hazardous levels of MGP waste would be coming in under what they call a non-hazardous spatial waste. Now, non-hazardous to you and me means something different than it does to the agency. But that's what the PCB waste was going to be coming in as, and also the MGP waste. And so there again, they promised the land or the county that they would not bring in the PCBs that's regulated by TSCA, and then also they wouldn't bring in materials that tested as hazardous. And then also there's a written application, and in the written application for local siting, it basically said the same thing, that the waste coming into the landfill would not contain PCBs regulated by TSCA and would not contain hazardous materials. So there again, this becomes the link between the local siting and the state permit. Now, this was in 2002. DeWitt County gave them a siting, as is a conditional siting. And so everything sounded good, sounded like they were going to get a municipal waste landfill out of this deal. We turned the clock forward to 2005. Now, once the landfill gets a local siting, they have 3 years to act on that. After 3 years, they have to go back through the local siting permit process, and that becomes very tedious. And so in 2005, the landfill applied to the state for an application for a permit to develop the landfill. So this would be actually to construct the landfill and actually make it operational. And here's the operating plan they submitted in 2005. And if you notice, it does match what was in our local siting in 2002. It also says that they would not bring in the TSCA PCBs and the hazardous levels of any material. And then June 2006. Now what's happened in since June 2006? The landfill's affiliate, Peoria Disposal, has had a true hazardous waste landfill in Peoria County. And they had an expansion. They had applied for Peoria County for an expansion to that landfill. And in May of 2006, they got turned down by their county. And so their options for their hazardous waste, which is where the really nasty stuff would have went, got turned down. So we see here, now this is the operating plan with the Illinois EPA. A month after they got turned down by Peoria County, all of a sudden, okay, here's the 2002 operating plan. There's the initial 2005. And then in 2006, we see a change. A month after they got turned down for their hazardous waste expansion, we see where all of a sudden the language has changed. And it says waste with PCB concentrations of greater than 50 parts per million are unacceptable, except with specific RCRA or TSCA allowances for greater concentrations. So that little caveat, you know, all of a sudden now before they're saying we will never accept this. Now they're saying, well, we'll only accept it if we get a TSCA permit. So somehow, within the agency, this changed. And we don't know how. We don't know why. No one's been able to tell us how this got changed in midstream. But that's a huge difference between what the original siting said. And the Illinois EPA approved the permit to develop in March of 2007. So now we turn the clock forward another year. Now we go to DeWitt County. DeWitt County, at the Finance Committee meeting, there was on the agenda was a line item said amendment to the host agreement to support rail service. And so this cruised through the Finance Committee, went to the full board 2 days later, got approved. And what do we find out what was in that amendment? It says the county supports and approves the permitting development, construction, and operation of the chemical waste landfill by CLI. So not exactly the rail spur that was on the agenda, right? So this was slid under the radar, and it was approved by the county before the public ever knew about it. So what did the public do? Public, they were up in arms. They were understandably very upset, and because basically their county board had sold them literally down the river. And so November 2008 ballot, they were going to put a referendum asking the county board to rescind this amendment to the host agreement that gave them the approval to build this chemical waste landfill. And so, and by the way, this referendum passed by around 75%. But look what the county board did the month before the referendum came out. Well, they came out with a second host amendment. And instead of saying, well, we support the chemical waste landfill, now they said, well, we're basically too stupid to know what's best for our people, so we're going to leave it up to the EPA to decide what's best for us. Even though we're the elected officials of your county and we have your back on this. We're going to let the EPA and the US EPA decide for you. And they said, as a result, the county neither supports or opposes the permitting, development, construction of this chemical waste landfill. So basically, they look the other way. They've been saying, we're just going to look the other way. We're going to let these guys, these unelected officials, these agency guys, decide what's best for our county. I don't know how they rationalize that in their mind. I don't know how any elected body could ever give away the right to look over the protection of their people's water, but they did. So the Illinois EPA in 2010, they gave permit modification number 9, which gave the landfill permission to receive the NGP waste at hazardous levels, and also the PCB waste that's regulated by TSCA. Now those are two brand new waste streams. Those have never been accepted before at Clinton Landfill. And then also subdivide the landfill into what they call the municipal solid waste unit and a chemical waste unit. Now, this is unprecedented. No one has ever, subdivided a landfill before. And there's no such thing as a chemical waste unit in Illinois environmental regulations at all. And so they just made it up. They basically made up this term so they could make this new unit. And I mean, you might as well call it a unicorn corral, because it doesn't exist. I mean, it just, nowhere in regulations does it exist. But anyway, so the Illinois EPA gave them this approval, and then this is what we got. This is the chemical waste unit at Clinton Landfill. This is in the early days. What you see there is them pushing, at that time was NGP waste, into the chemical waste unit. We don't know what the large volume of water is. This color doesn't look very good, but it was a blue water. And we don't know why it's there. It was supposed to, before it came into operation, it was supposed to have a fully functional leachate collection system. But, you know, there's a lot of water sitting in that landfill. But, like I say, this is 23 acres. If fully, completely filled, it'd hold about 2.5 million tons of chemical waste. Now, in the meantime, okay, we go to 2013. The DeWitt County Board turned over in 2012 and got an anti-chemical waste majority. And so finally, the board says, you know, we're going to pass a resolution supporting the coalition's effort on the siting complaint. And as a result, the landfill withheld their host fees. It took until August 2014 for the county to actually file suit against the landfill to get their fees back, but anyway. And then now we go to 2014. It's election year. The governor got some pressure on him, and so he finally leans on the Illinois EPA, and they give modification number 47, which takes back those two waste streams, the hazardous NGP and the PCB waste. Doesn't get rid of this chemical waste unit. That didn't go away. That's still there. So as a result, in those 4 years, we've got 30,000 tons of poisonous MGP source material in the landfill. And that may not sound like much. I've heard it argued that that's only less than 2% of what the total could have been. Well, that 30,000 tons, you know, that's equivalent to about 2,500 school buses or 75 747s. I mean, that's still a lot of waste, and it's going to be at the bottom of the landfill, and it's going to be being pushed down by that $2.5 million or tons of other waste. And that's going to be sitting on top of three liners of 60 mils apiece. And 60 mils is equivalent to about two credit cards. So if you take two credit card cards, that's one liner, and there's three of those. And the MGP waste, we know, has solvents in it that can degrade the liners. So how long it's going to last? Who knows? The US EPA says all landfills leak. Now, DeWitt County, even though they were in the rights, they sued the landfill. Come April 2015, they decided to play nice. The board turned over again. The guy who made the motion to approve the chemical waste landfill is now our county board chairman. And so now they want to make nice with the landfill. So they've got this settlement with them that, and one of the items in it, they said they'll never ask CLI to remove this waste. And there again, they've been asked to look the other way again. And you might ask why they would do it. I'll give you over a million reasons why they would do it. Because they get over $1 million from this landfill every year. So that, as our state's attorney called it, that's our cash cow. So anyway, I don't have time to go through a lot of this. I just want to end real quick. There's a lot of things that they basically turned over. I just want to end with this one right here. I think this tells the whole picture. This was sent by a photographer in the Clinton area, and he sent this to me, and in his email he says, here's a photograph of our daughter drinking from a spigot this summer near Clinton. This has been there since I was her age. We have safely drank from it since we were kids. I wonder if her kids will be able to drink from it. And this is what it's all about. We can't get distracted. We can't get distracted by the politics. We can't get distracted by the arguments. You know, we're not saving our future, we're saving her future. And if we can't remember that, then we should just back away from it. We have to remember it's all about their future. They have no voice in this. Nobody asked them their input on this this agreement with the siting, anything. So we may never have to deal with it, but someone will. So that's all I have. I thank you for the time.
That was Steve Bridges from Mahomet Aquifer Protection Alliance. Thank you, Steve. Our next speaker is Kathleen Pyatt, who is a former Piatt County board member, and she's been involved in the effort to protect the Mahomet Aquifer for a while, and she'll be speaking about accomplishments and the importance of citizen action.
Thank you, Claudia, not only for the introduction, but for your generous contributions of efforts, your organizational skills, and your heart. I am at core an Ivesdale Irish girl. I grew up on a farm in Champaign County, some 7 miles north of Ivesdale. I'm a teacher, retired. I'm a wife. I'm a mother of three, and a proud grandmother of three as well. In the interest of organizing some background information concerning action taken to protect Mahomet Aquifer due to citizen involvement, I would like to provide a simple timeline of developments that date back to 2007. Steve Bridges already provided some information prior to that. This is when CLI began the process for obtaining permits for a chemical waste landfill through the IEPA and the US EPA. The chemical waste landfill would be located within a portion of Clinton Landfill Number 3, located over the Mahomet Aquifer, drinking water source for not only Clinton and DeWitt County, but more than 13 other Illinois counties. Concerned citizen groups began organizing to deter the outcome and protect the aquifer. Groups like Watch, groups like MAPA. By 2009, citizen concerns prompted a special meeting of the Mahomet Valley Water Authority, established pursuant to the Water Authorities Act and charged with protecting the water quality and water supply for DeWitt and Piatt County, where I live now. The Mahomet Valley Water Authority trustees voted to, and I quote, become involved in contesting the CLI permit application. Between 2009 and 2010, Clinton Landfill Inc. leveled legal efforts against the Mahomet Valley Water Authority, contesting its authority and seeking an injunction to prevent its opposition to the permitting process. The courts dismissed CLI's complaints and denied an injunction against the Water Authority. Ordinance 68 was formed and reformed by the Mahomet Valley Water Authority to provide water quality oversight and monitor landfill operations. Ordinance 68 was recently repealed as the Mahomet Valley Water Authority studies the implications of the consent decree. In August of 2012, constituent concerns about PCB disposal over the aquifer inspired House Bill 6153. A public hearing was held at the Piatt County Farm Bureau by the Illinois House Environmental Health Committee. The bill's sponsors, Representative Naomi Jacobson and Chapin Rose. The bill would have prohibited PCB waste disposal at the Clinton landfill. The committee took testimony at the committee took testimony from local government representatives, the Farm Bureau, the IEPA environmental specialists, scholars, and concerned citizens. I was there. Witnessing this hearing was an eye-opening experience. It was impressive in its scope and size. There were so many people crammed into our local Farm Bureau office, standing room only, people hanging out in the kitchen with a pass-through window. The voice of the people was powerful at that meeting, and I was truly moved. House Bill 6153 did not make it to a vote, but it paved the way for legislation to come. In December of 2012, application was made to the US EPA for sole source aquifer designation of the Mahomet Aquifer. This represented hours and hours of volunteer efforts and expertise. This accomplishment will be explored later in the program by those who were deeply involved in that effort. 2014 was an extraordinary year of aquifer protection efforts. Aquifer summits were organized and conducted by community leaders and were held in 5 counties to update volunteers and leaders to educate the public concerning efforts toward protection of the aquifer. Public hearings in 2014 for sole source designation had record turnouts. By late summer, the IEPA rescinded CL's permit for MGP and PCBs, and the US EPA declined to move forward with the Clinton landfill applications for PCBs. Both DeWitt and Piatt counties included referenda in 2014 on the November ballot regarding toxic waste at the Clinton landfill. 90% of DeWitt voters and 94% of Piatt voters weighed in against toxic chemical waste at Clinton landfill. Voters' voices were loud and strong. Now, 2015. 2015 has included encouraging accomplishments as well, like the passing of House Bill 1326, Senate Bill 1698, prohibiting MGP and PCB waste above certain concentration levels from being dumped where it could contaminate the aquifer. Sponsors were Representative Carol Ammons and Senator Scott Bennett. Sole source aquifer designation was at last granted by the US EPA in March of 2015. And in May, Clinton Landfill withdrew its federal application for PCBs, despite preliminary approval. None of these accomplishments would have happened without citizen action and involvement. All these actions are important, but limited victories. Efforts must continue. And people must continue to educate themselves and remain engaged and involved. The work continues to protect our aquifer. We need to build on the successes to date by changing state laws and regulations governing landfills and dangerous waste. And I thank you.
Thank you, Kathleen. Our next speaker is Illinois State Senator Scott Bennett from the 52nd District. And as he is on his way up here, I just wanted to mention that Representative Carol Ammons was unable to be here today, but she sends her regards and she's one of the co-sponsors, and the two of them were the chief sponsors of the bills that you're going to be hearing about.
Good morning, and it is so good to see this many faces. I'm not surprised, but it's great to see so many people come out for the very important cause. My name is Scott Bennett. I am the Illinois State Senator for the 52nd District. So those of you that live in Champaign-Urbana and Rantoul and the southern part of Vermilion County, I'm your state senator. I'm new. I came in January at the same time Representative Ammons did, and I think we, in our early meetings, We recognize that there was no higher priority than one than legislation affecting the Muhammad Aquifer. As Kathleen pointed out earlier, we were not the first to take this on. And I think important voices and important names that should be commended for how we got here include then Senator Mike Frerichs, now our state treasurer, and also Naomi Jacobson, for bringing on this legislation year after year, session after session, and really working toward it. The fact that Carol and I were able to get legislation passed this year speaks more, I think, about this cumulative effect, the snowball rolling down that hill, and so many people that came before us until we got to the point where we had this alliance of people that were willing to come to bat for us. And I can think of no starker example than that, than just to give you a little example. The first bill that Carol and I had, the same bill, I introduced it in the Senate, she introduced it in the House. And we wanted to see kind of where it ended up, because in the past, it might get through one chamber and then die in the other. And we wanted to see, well, how can we make sure it gets through this year? As it came about, my bill got to committee first. And so back, I think it was in early February, it came up for a vote. And this is one, it was my first bill that got through, or got to committee. And didn't know what to expect, but I had people say to me, well, you got lucky, because who's going to be against, you know, precautions of, you know, poisoning a water supply, right? Everybody's going to be for that. That'll be an easy bill to get through. And then about Thursday or Friday before that week, we started getting calls. And we started hearing about all these groups that were suddenly against it and how much opposition we were going to have. Business groups, landfill groups, all these others that were going to come and oppose our bill in the committee. And that weekend, Representative Carol Ammons and myself spent a lot of time on the phone trying to figure out, what do we need to do? How do we get people to the meeting? How do we show that this is not a one-sided issue? In fact, if anything, it's much more heavily weighted for precautions for that Muhammad Aquifer. But how do you explain that to a room full of committeemen and senators that may not live anywhere near this huge district of that map you showed? And how do we show its importance? And to make matters worse, there was an ice storm that weekend. And so suddenly, a lot of the people that we had hoped could come would find out they couldn't even get their cars out of their driveways, much less get all the way to Springfield in the middle of the week. And that's when the Alliance came in, and healthcare consumers came in. And suddenly we started getting email after email, because now you don't have to go all the way to Springfield to let your voice be heard. You could file your opposition or your support for a bill online. But a lot of people didn't know that until some of the groups in this room let people know that. And so when we walked in that room for the committee, yeah, we had all the lawyers and the lobbyists for the big business groups and the landfill groups. And we also had, as the committee chairman said, there's 180 some people that have filed support of Senator Bennett's bill online. And suddenly you see the committee, 180? That does deserve some applause. That's a lot of the people in this room that got busy and let their voices be heard. And what Kathleen pointed out earlier, the power of citizen action, the power of people getting involved, that is never, I can think of no starker example of that than in this bill and people getting involved. Now, we got it through committee that day. In large part, you saw the eyebrows raised by a committee member. Okay, well, I guess we should hear them out. And I know George Wismiller and some others made that treacherous trek all the way to Springfield and let them know the history of this fight. Let them know the risks if the landfill companies are wrong with some of their assessments of their protections. And we passed committee that day. And ultimately, we were able to get that bill passed through both houses, both the Senate and the House. And the governor actually signed it himself. And I know Claudia was there with us in Monticello and Piatt County when they were honoring that the signing ceremony for that. So what does that bill do? That bill does some important things. It talks about municipal gas plant waste as highly toxic waste. You saw some of those pictures, that's what that was, MGP waste from some of the landfill. And that is waste that, as was current, could be put in municipal waste landfills. The EPA, the state, their lawyers, and several other environmental scholars came to us and said, you know, there's actually nothing. The EPA is trying to make sure this doesn't come in if it's over a certain toxicity level. And they use a thing called a T-clip. Don't ask me to tell you what that acronym stands for. But the T-clip, that's the measure to see how toxic it is. And if it's over a certain amount, then we know it's dangerous, and then we don't let you put it in municipal waste. But there's nothing in the law that actually says that. So as soon as the lawyers and lobbyists for these landfill companies realize there's a lot of money to be made in those, they got an easy leg to stand on in court. And so that's what this bill did. We went through and we made sure that this MGP waste, you couldn't store any more of it in municipal wastes. municipal landfills. And that's important, I think. I think, you know, I also have two young children. Made me think of that when I saw the little girl with the drinking spigot. And that's what this is all about, is making sure, what do we do from today going forward to make sure that's safer? We also got some very good news as this bill is going forward. Of course, the sole source designation. I'm not telling anybody anything they don't know. And of course, our last two speakers spoke on that. And that was information we didn't have. That was a designation we did not have when we began this process back in January. So what do we do from there? Under federal law, there are some important things that come along with once a water source, once it's been given this very rare designation of a sole source. But however, if it's a project that is funded fully by state funds or local funds, there's no federal protections for that. And that's what Representative Ammons and I hope to address going forward. We recognize that what was passed was important, and we all should just realize how important the work of the Alliance is to this point. But the point that was made earlier is exactly right. We cannot lose our momentum now. Now we've got this coalition. Now where do we go with it from here? How about we don't just be reactive and we find out, wait, you've been putting what in our water supply? How about we say, let's look forward, what's the next risk going to be, and address it before they're actually putting it over our water supply. And that's where we're going to be working on from this point. Thank you. And I see my timing is wrapping up, so I will say this in closing. This is a process that Representative Ammons and I take very seriously, and we recognize neither of us are environmental scholars. We are not scientists. What we are public servants that care a lot about this issue. And we recognize, and I know we brought Claudia to meetings, I've talked to Joe Hooker as we went through the session, and many other people as I'm looking in the room, I leaned on as we tried to figure out what's the best way to phrase this legislation going forward. What can we give up in this negotiation, and what do we need to stand up for? And that's what we're going to need to talk about going forward. So we're going to have probably some town halls. I think that'd be a great idea as we go forward. Right now, as you all know, the budget is what's taking all our energy. Until that budget gets addressed, we're not going to talk about the other stuff. But what we are doing is trying to craft that legislation and work from there. And I know in my office, my closest office is the MTD Terminal Building. SenatorBennett.com is our website. I invite you, if you have ideas of what you'd like to see in that legislation, please reach out to me and make your voice heard so that we make sure that the next legislation going forward does what we need it to do going forward. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Senator Bennett. Our next presenter is Alan Werman, who is, we're actually really excited to have him here. He is the gentleman who put together the application for the sole source aquifer designation. And I will ask him to come up here. And if you need to introduce yourself further, you can, but that's sort of a big deal.
So good morning. Yes, I was one of the on the team that put together the petition that went to US EPA to get the sole source designation. It's a readable document, but contains some fairly technical material. It's about the complete document's probably about 100 pages long, and the whole idea is that the EPA wants to have, you know, that technical expertise behind it before they make the designation, before they actually pass the designation. So just quickly, this is a map of the bedrock valleys across central United States. And if you can see that red line, let's see if I can use a pointer here. Well, the traces of this valley in the bedrock surface back across Indiana and Ohio, all the way actually up into what we believe is West Virginia, that is the trace of this Mahomet, or what was called the Taze Bedrock Valley. So it's an ancient pre-glacial drainage that coursed across central United States. If we take a closer look, and many of you have seen this map before, it's at the back of the room. This is basically the valley as it occurs in Illinois. And that bottom of that valley is filled up with sand, and it's the water within the pore spaces of that sand that we're pumping out and drinking and using for a variety of purposes. And that is what forms the aquifer. It's the water in this sand deposit in the bottom of this ancient valley. Now, the petition itself and the what the US EPA granted, it looks a little bit different than this, and we'll show you here. The basic difference is the US EPA does not like to use political boundaries as their boundaries for their sole source designations, and so we had to basically cut the aquifer off the east end along the North Fork of the Vermilion River. And frankly, as we go east from there, the aquifer isn't nearly as prolific as it is here in central Illinois. And there's evidence to suggest, in fact, that the water in the aquifer in the eastern end is actually flowing down towards the Wabash as exiting out the Wabash. So it's really, in a sense, kind of hydrologically separate from the Illinois portion that we're most concerned about. Now, this technical document goes into some detail to discuss what alternative water supplies are or are not available, and the whole idea being that there isn't another source of water available for all the communities that are currently using the aquifer now. And that could be on the basis of either quantity or, in many cases, economically. For a small town situated over the middle of the aquifer, if that were to become contaminated and they had to run a pipeline someplace else, it's fiscally impossible for these towns to finance a big project like that when you're talking about, you know, $500,000 a mile for pipeline. So we were able to show to the EPA that this is our water source and it's our only water source, and please grant us this designation. So what does that designation do? Well, first of all, the program itself was established within the Safe Drinking Water Act of 1974. So it's been around for 40 plus years. It's not a new program. There are some 70, 75 sole source aquifers across the United States. This is the first and only one in Illinois. Under the sole source aquifer designation, certain federally funded or federally assisted projects must receive this extra review by the US EPA to make sure that our taxpayer dollars are not being used on a project that might potentially contaminate the aquifer. If the project is not felt to be a hazard, then the project review is fairly quick. I've been assured by Region 5 people involved in this that a normal review would probably take less than a couple of weeks, and they could move on with the project. Federal funds could also be used to modify the project to reduce that contamination risk or eliminate that contamination risk. Projects that are deemed to pose a hazard would go back to the proponent of the project for modification such that it does no longer pose a hazard. If they cannot do that, the federal funds would be denied. Remember, this is for federally funded projects only. Privately funded projects would not receive this scrutiny. An additional thing that I know has been a topic of much discussion is that with the sole source aquifer designation, there are stricter requirements for landfills under the Illinois EPA Act. So there is some extra requirements there. I'm not going to get into detail on that. I just want to close with the thought that when we went into this designation process, the whole idea was that with the designation, the idea is that we do have to follow it up with local, state and local efforts to try and do more than just what the federal law will do. And that requires the activity of all of us here today. Doing some of the work such as Senator Bennett just talked about, doing more to add protections to the aquifer. There are other threats out there that will be discussed more later today as well, not just the Clinton landfill. So we want to be able to be active in that. The sole source designation is just one step. I think it does a good job of telling people that this is our only source of water and we need to preserve it. And that should be enough footing to move forward from there. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Alan. And I wanna thank all the speakers so far. Y'all have been really good about sticking on time and I really appreciate it. Our next speaker is Bill Spencer from WATCH, and he's going to be talking about ongoing and new threats to the aquifer from Clinton Landfill.
My name is Bill Spencer. I'm a member of WATCH Clinton Landfill. WATCH was created in 2007 when a few concerned citizens joined together to find out what was going on at Clinton Landfill. For 8 years, WATCH has relentlessly worked to bring the truth to the people of Central Illinois about the goings-on of Clinton Landfill and its threat to the Mahomet Aquifer. This presentation will give you a good understanding of what Clinton Landfill has done and how they fooled the government, officials, and the public to get what they wanted. This presentation will also cover two major concerns of the consent decree: 30,000 tons of MGP hazardous waste and the chemical waste unit that had its permit revoked. Both would be allowed by the consent decree if approved by the coalition. You are seeing what WATCH and the US EPA discovered in 2011. This was the first knowledge that the chemical waste unit was built and taking waste. Federal officials were shocked by this picture, along with the public and WATCH. This picture documents many things about Clinton Landfill and its plans to accept toxic chemical waste. The red arrow points to the area of the hazardous chemical waste unit that began receiving MGP waste. This was the first waste received in the hazardous chemical waste unit. WATCH questioned many things in this infamous picture. One was the bright blue water. WATCH discovered that the waste in the landfill was from MGP waste cleanups and understood that MGP cleanups included filter box waste that could easily produce this blue color in the water. MGP cleanup waste is found to be highly contaminated with cyanide from filters used to purify coal gas. If rainwater is allowed to pass through the MGP waste, it will extract the Prussian blue cyanide, creating the blue water. This is extremely common. Strangely enough, Clinton Landfill claimed it was caused by hydrated lime that was being used to solidify liquid hazardous waste that had been dumped in the unit. This caused a chemical reaction by the lime and was what made the blue color, according to them. Note the red arrows. What is more shocking than the blue water is in the photo is the missing gravel layer that should be present on the liner. This was noted by the federal government too. This facility was in violation from the first time it accepted waste. The basic primary protection of a hazardous landfill is by way of collecting liquid hazardous leachate that drains from the stored waste to the bottom of the toxic chemical waste unit. This is done by way of a gravel drainage system. This process was not completed before receiving the MGP waste. I would like you to remember this photo from 2011. And this specific exposed point on the liner. You can't talk about a landfill without addressing its critical parts. Red arrows here point to the pump system. The only properly allowed process for removing liquid from the hazardous chemical waste unit is by pumping it out to holding tanks so it can be transported for treatment. Instead of removing the cyanide-tainted rainwater with the sump pump system, Clinton Landfill chose to push lime into the sump pit to absorb the cyanide pool, causing a permanent blockage for the sump pump extraction system. With no way to discharge the collected water in the bottom of the hazardous chemical waste unit, tainted water would then build up, discharging directly over the edge of the protective liner onto the unprotected soil into the Mahomet Aquifer. If you look closely to the pipe system, you will notice that it is not connected to the storage tanks. This leaves the hazardous chemical waste unit unable to protect the environment from the hazardous toxic waste that it is containing. Remember, this photo was taken 2 months after receiving permission to receive waste from the Illinois EPA by a secret permit granted on April Fool's Day. Now let's look at a real landfill. This picture is of a landfill that was completed, its liner and drainage system installed. Note, no pumps have been installed. This was not done piecemeal, but completed before receiving any waste. Note that the leachate collection tank in the background is present. Also notice there is a groundwater retention system in the front. Clinton Landfill does not think any of these things are needed in their landfill. This is 4 years later. Same landfill, Clinton Landfill's chemical waste unit. I would like to remind you that Watch is the only one keeping an eye on what is going on here other than Clinton Landfill and the IEPA. MGP waste has been stopped, but coal waste is taking its place. Clinton Landfill is not placing any more waste on top of the MGP waste. I asked you to note this spot in the liner in a previous slide back in 2011. This picture here was just taken just a couple months ago. I would like you to note that Clinton Landfill still has not covered that spot in the liner with the required gravel drainage layer. They more than likely didn't put a gravel drainage layer under any of it. A closer look at the chemical waste unit, the MGP waste and the CCR, you can see coal tar bubbling to the surface. Don't worry about it though. The next time it rains, it'll flush it right into the river. This is a good overview of the total current facility today. Landfill 1 is the oldest and is pre-RCRA. It is in corrective action and is leaking into the Mahomet Aquifer. Landfill 2. Actually, I call that the other Clinton Lake. It has 70 feet of leachate standing in it. You can see Landfill 3 is under construction. This landfill is not expected to have any of its final groundwater protections in place for another 20 years or more. Unlike the landfill I showed you in the earlier slide, that was 100% completed before receiving its first load of waste, Landfill 3 and its chemical waste units are mega landfills that are being placed or pieced together piece by piece. The liners are not completed. There's no continuous collection systems. There's nothing. No storage tanks. This mega landfill also comes with a convenience drain in the chemical waste unit. This was planned by the EPA so it could drain to the river. That way, Two, the regular landfill's leachate can pass through the hazardous waste on its way to the river. This will also avoid the repeat of landfill 2 and its 70 feet of leachate. Liners are permanently damaged when exposed to 1 foot or more of leachate. Draining leachate may be good for the landfill, but not good for the life downriver. All leachate is regulated as highly and acutely hazardous waste. This is a drawing that shows the current status of the landfill. The yellow area represents the completed part of the planned mega waste cell inside the Muhammad Aquifer. The cell has been under development for 8 years. The green and blue locations will take a minimum of 20 years to reach final development. During this time, no final safeguards will be in place to protect the Muhammad Aquifer. Currently, this type of subterranean waste facility takes time to be built. The end. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Bill Spencer. That was a little tricky because we're not supposed to be talking about the consent decree here today because we have so much other stuff to do. But since that presentation focused on the consent decree, what we will do is we will take some time at the beginning of the Q&A session and Joe Hooker will make some remarks. Our next presentation actually is going to be about coal combustion waste, and I would like to welcome Tyler Rochke from Prairie Rivers Network to come up. And part of the reason that we wanted to feature Tyler today to talk about this is because this is some of the waste that can go and is going into the Clinton landfill. And so he's sort of an expert on it, so I will let him come up. Thank you.
Good morning, and thank you for the opportunity to present today. My name is Tyler Rochke. I work as a water policy specialist with Prairie Rivers Network. Just hoping to talk a bit about coal ash, what exactly it is, how it's classified by state and federal regulators, and some of the issues that might be presented with disposal here. So coal ash is basically the solid byproduct that's left after burning coal in power plants to produce electricity. Much in the same way that you're left with ash after you burn wood in a fire, you're left with ash after you burn coal in a power plant. And this becomes problematic originally because many of our power plants are are situated next to rivers and lakes because of their heavy demands for water for cooling. So what you end up with coal ash is a few different products. You have the fly ash that's light enough to be carried up with the flue gas. You have the bottom ash that's heavier and lands at the bottom of the boiler. Boiler slag, which is when the bottom ash actually melts from the heat. And then flue gas desulfurization waste, which just comes with the scrubbers and their processes. They're all sort of described as coal ash, and at the federal level, they're all put under the umbrella of coal combustion residuals. Where it becomes a concern is that the coal ash contains a number of constituents, mercury, arsenic, lead, cadmium, and chromium, all of which are present in coal originally, but with the combustion process and the carbon that's removed with the oxygen, you're left with these constituents at much higher concentrations, many of which are associated with different forms of cancer and nervous system damage, and other things that can impact human health. So as I mentioned originally, a lot of the coal fired power plants in the state are situated next to lakes and streams, and as a result, the coal ash that's disposed on site also is next to these lakes and streams, and this is where the majority of it is disposed of, so I just wanted to put that in this presentation for reference. Many of these locations are unsuitable and risky, 56 over groundwater recharge areas, 62 over shallow aquifers, and 9 over wetlands, and a lot of them have problems of their own, particularly with structural integrity. Being in The floodplain presents problems with erosional forces, and many of them also tend to be situated over mine voids. So where the classification becomes a little bit more tricky is that in Illinois, there's a distinction between coal combustion waste and coal combustion byproduct. So at the federal level, it's all labeled as CCR, which includes all those different, the fly ash, the bottom ash that I talked about earlier. In Illinois, there's a further distinction between waste and byproduct that's sort of an odd tautology in that how it's used determines how it can be used. So coal combustion waste and byproduct are the same thing, but when it's disposed of in a way that's considered beneficial, it's under the regulations of coal combustion byproduct. So beneficial use might be using it as a soil amendment. It might be putting it on roadways as a de-icing agent. It might be taking a ravine and deciding that that ravine needs to be filled up, and that's considered a beneficial use. So that's why it's sort of important considering it in this location, because what I'm going to be talking about is coal combustion waste. So in the instance that the Clinton landfill would want to use coal ash as a de-icing agent or to fill a ravine to level out the grade on the site, that would be under coal combustion byproduct, which is hardly regulated and has minimal procedures for notification. But when you look at coal combustion waste, in Illinois, by default, EPA tends to classify it as special waste. And most landfills in the state are certified as special waste landfills, which means that a lot of landfills currently are taking coal combustion waste. What makes it slightly more interesting is that the special waste can be declassified in a process where the operator, so the owner of the power plant, self-certifies coal combustion waste as non-hazardous, non-special waste. And that's also a fairly common process and somewhat difficult to track down because it's a self-certification that's in a file that's kept on site that the EPA has to request and go track down. So if they choose to certify as non-special, non-hazardous, then you lose a lot of those requirements for keeping a manifest or having a special waste transporter. So as a result, coal ash, as it seems, is planned to be dumped in the chemical waste unit, which as compared to a lot of those coal ash sites that I described earlier, over 60% of which are unlined, is more protective. But I guess that's sort of just an unfortunate fact wherein one of the most protective sites we can choose is in a risky location over an aquifer that provides water for us all. But it doesn't just have to be stored in the chemical waste unit. It could also be stored in the other landfill facility or in other landfill sites across the state. And if it's categorized as non-hazardous, non-special, then you lose the requirements for a manifest and the special waste haulers, and it becomes a lot more difficult to track down. So how does disposal here compare to coal ash disposal generally? Landfills, just like the new US EPA regulations for coal ash, which are set to come into force in October, they're both regulated under RCRA solid waste provisions. So a lot of the provisions for groundwater protection and corrective action end up looking fairly similar. And if a landfill is designed to meet the hazardous waste Subtitle C requirements, it's going to be more protective than a lot of the requirements that are currently applied to coal ash. The concerns that arise in addition to that are likely with groundwater monitoring, in that it may not be taking into account or into consideration some of the constituents that are present in coal ash and that should be in the groundwater monitoring regime at this site. So that's all I have on that. Thank you.
Could I just say, in 3 days in this room, Tyler, along with Pam and Lana Richard of EcoJustice Collaborative, there's going to be a meeting about specifically about coal ash, an informational meeting sponsored by State Representative Carol Emmons and Prairie Rivers and some others. So if you didn't get a flyer on the way in, you can get it on the way out. So that's Tuesday afternoon at 5:30 in this room.
I don't know where the other light switch is to get the lights back on, so if somebody knows, that would be great. Oh, I thought I tried that. Thank you very much. Thank you, Tyler, for your presentation, and thank you, Stuart, for making that announcement. Our next speaker is going to be Steve Carter, representing the Government Coalition, talking about possible paths forward. And real quick, I just wanted to take a moment and see how many elected officials are here today. Oh, that's great. We have quite a few county board members from different county boards, city council members. Mayor Deb Finan was here earlier. I don't know if she's still here. But thank you all very much for attending. And now I will turn it over to Steve.
Thanks very much, Claudia. You know, this is one of the most complex issues you would ever want to deal with in terms of the geology of it, the legal framework, the governmental framework, because there's local, federal, and state roles to play. It's just extremely complex, which made it very interesting, but it's also made it very difficult. When we began this, when we first got our calls, when I was still the city manager in Champaign, 2011, we really were in an emergency response mode, because if you recall, US EPA was getting ready to allow the disposal of the storage of PCBs at the Clinton landfill. So there was a lot of motivation to do something quickly. And actually, we thought our first actions were going to be suing the US EPA to try to keep them from moving forward with the permit. Fortunately, things have moved on since then. We've had some success. So it's really time to focus on the longer term needs. And from the very beginning, we're saying, you know, this is really a long-term issue. What we do in a year or 2 years probably isn't going to solve or take care of this issue as long as it needs to be taken care of, which is in perpetuity, really. And I think the challenge for us moving forward is whether or not we can develop and sustain a thoughtful plan of action to protect the aquifer. We're great. There's an emergency. As individuals, part of our culture, our governmental institutions, we can rally and, you know, attack that issue that's threatening us right now. But when it comes time to developing a longer-term, thoughtful strategy and sustaining that effort over time, we're not so good at it. And I think that's our challenge moving forward. If we can't come up with a good plan to sustain it over many, many years, at some point, our aquifer will be compromised. So there are a lot of questions that come up. You know, what can we do? And so I spent some time talking to folks, many of the folks here, just coming up with, well, what are some of the things we could do moving forward? We're not going to be able to do all of them. We don't have unlimited resources, time, money, for example. And so at some point, we're going to have to sit down and think, well, what are really the priorities here? And what are the different roles? The Government Coalition may have one role, citizens may have another role, all aimed at the same ultimate goal of protecting the aquifer, but we may have different strengths and weaknesses. And so we need to figure out a way that we can develop a plan, identify the roles, and sustain that over time. So you have in your handout kind of a quick listing of some of the things that we've talked about. And nothing has been decided. There's no plan in place. It's something that we're going to have to develop moving forward. The first thing is monitor the Clinton landfill. There's a lot of distrust of the operator, of the regulators, and so, you know, we need to look for increased transparency. We need to have some technical expertise to monitor what's happening there and follow up and take action if we need to. The second item is to seek additional legislative protection. Several people have mentioned that today. Originally, our thought was, well, we need to have a law that bans new or expanded landfills. There are other states in the nation who, through their statutes or through their regulations, have done that. So that would probably be our highest priority. There are a lot of other legal options as well that we need to take a look at. The whole idea of, well, is this the best way to handle hazardous waste? You know, maybe the state could find some funding once they ultimately adopt a budget to actually have pilot programs to try some other ways of maybe recycling or neutralizing some of these hazardous waste. The third item is, you know, protecting the aquifer recharge areas. There's been a lot of study done of the aquifer, but I think people would tell you that we haven't identified all the recharge areas, and where we can identify them, how do we protect them to make sure that we're not providing an easy path for contaminants to reach the aquifer? The fourth area is public education, and this is one of the things that really the Soul Source Aquifer has spurred us to do, and has really, like today, we've seen there's a lot of interest in the community, but there's also a lot of confusion, and you know, it's one of those things that it's not in the newspaper today, a week later, why you know, people have turned their attention to something else. So there's an ongoing effort needed to continue public education through brochures, meetings like this, service club presentations, farmers market, everything that we can think of. And really, this is a role that citizens have played really well over the last few years. The fifth area is seek appropriate protection for high capacity wells. For the first time in the history of Illinois, all high capacity wells are required to report their location and the amount of pumping that they're doing. That report will be available sometime at the end of the year. Right now, we don't have any idea for actually how much water is being pumped out of the aquifer, where those wells are actually located. A lot of them will be irrigation wells, obviously. So, and every time you have a well that goes into the aquifer, it's a potential source of contamination. So, you know, how do we make sure that these wells are protected so they don't provide an entryway for contamination? Six, research existing landfills and closed landfills above the aquifer. Several people over the years have made this point. I mean, we're talking about one landfill here, the Clinton landfill, which has been the focus of our attention. But there are a lot of other landfills out there. There are landfills in Champaign-Urbana we need to be concerned about. There's a closure. Champaign has a landfill on 150 that's going through closure. They've revised their whole monitoring system there to try to make sure that they're aware of any problems that come out of that. The Urbana landfill, which Champaign's a partner of, again, it's through closure, but there's ongoing monitoring going there. There are maybe a biggest area of concern for me right now would be Rantoul, the closed Air Force base, and the village of Rantoul has a water supply on the air base as well. And I know, you know, they're really watching that very carefully, but it's something that people in Champaign-Urbana ought to be concerned about as well. So looking at additional old landfills and monitoring those, what's happening in all of those, as well as the ones that are active. Seven is maintain readiness to initiate legal action. You know, quite frankly, we wouldn't be here today if we didn't have the ability to have attorneys step in and provide solutions and ideas and court action in order to get some of the other actions pending to stop. So we always have to have that as an option, to be able to step in and stop things and challenge things where we need to. Eighth is to maintain and strengthen the coalition. We have 14 active members of the coalition right now. We'd like to reach out and have every county involved. The village of Rantoul, you know, would be my first choice to bring into the coalition. They haven't been a part of that, but yet because of the air base and their interest in protecting the aquifer, they'd be a natural to join a coalition moving forward. But the coalition really needs to think about what its future role is as well. They're coming together for very specific purposes. Those purposes are kind of drawing to a close right now. And so they are the ones who really need to take a look at this list. And the governmental entities, will they continue the coalition? They may decide that, well, you know, what they can do is over. So maybe this is somebody else's job. I think not. We've had a lot of interest expressed as we've gone through these discussions with a consent decree. There's been a lot of interest indicated by the elected bodies that they want to continue this. But how will they continue it? What will be their focus? How are they going to fund it? How are they going to organize it? Particularly if we're looking at trying to keep some organization, some interest, some ongoing action into the future. Your ideas about what we should be doing in the future are important too. This is just a list of ideas to stimulate some thinking. If you have some ideas that you think the coalition or citizens should be pursuing as well, please send those to Claudia. I think she'll be kind of the repository of any of the ideas, and We'll share those then with all the parties involved. And I just reiterate, you know, I think our success to date hasn't been perfect, but we've made significant progress, and it's because we've had a lot of people all rowing the same direction. And that's very hard to do on an issue as complex as this. So we just all need to be committed to keep that goal in mind and find a role for ourselves and continue the effort that we've had. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. And to that end, I will talk about citizen involvement. And I just wanted to say, after I get done, finished, we'll make a little space time here for Joe Hooker to come and say his piece about the consent decree, and then we'll go into Q&A. And then we'll hear from Chapin Rose when he gets here. So what I wanted to do, following up on what Steve had to say about the need for people to stay involved, stay engaged, I wanted to ask you to turn your attention to the Get Involved, Take Action form that's at the back of your agenda packet. So this gives you the opportunity to get involved today, besides coming to the meeting. And if you want to fill it out, you would turn it in at the end of the meeting. Healthcare Consumers would collect that, and then we would add people to the cause. And you can fill out your personal information, how we can get in touch with you, and then select the boxes that are of interest to you. We're starting two petitions. One is calling for the creation of state legislation to permanently protect the Muhammad Aquifer. You've heard reference to that legislation, but as Senator Bennett said, it's going to take more than just our communities to work on that. This would be state legislation. It would be statewide. We need to start building a movement. The second petition would be calling for increased transparency in environmental test results at Clinton Landfill. We have to have a way for the people and officials to have greater vigilance about the test results. And it could be something as simple as the Illinois EPA putting up a page on their website where you can go and see the test results, as they have done with the Fifth and Hill neighborhood where there's an MGP cleanup going there. We had to fight for that in that case, and we might have to fight for it here too. You can also help us spread the word. You can get added to an email list so we can keep you informed about efforts. You can like Healthcare Consumers on Facebook, and you can share out using email, Facebook, or Twitter. And all of that helps to spread the word. And then lastly, but not least, just for today, we're interested in taking the pulse about whether people would be interested in doing a boycott of Clinton Landfill. Clinton Landfill is owned by PDC Area Disposal, which is a big garbage hauler here in this community for residential as well as industrial waste. And sometimes, and the governments do not endorse this, this is totally a citizen action possibility. But if people use PDC Area as their hauler and you're interested in participating in a boycott, you could check that box and we can work with you on that. And we do have information about alternative haulers. Even if you do not use PDC Area as your hauler but want to help support a boycott, you can check that box, and there will be many ways that you can do that. So these are just some ways to indicate your interest and the ways that you would like to participate as citizens. So I urge you to please fill out the form and turn it in before you leave. You can drop it off at the front desk. And now that concludes that part of my presentation. And what I would like to do, if you're prepared, Joe, is ask Joe and Dave if you want to come up. Let's give them 10 minutes, and then we're going to go into Q&A, but we'll bring Chapin Rose, Senator Rose, up when he gets here. Okay?
I'd like to mention that Cleanway is also a part of the PDC Area, because a lot of citizens use Cleanway.
Yes. So yes, that's correct. And let's hold off until Q&A for more back and forth discussion, please.
Hi, folks. Some of you have seen me many public meetings talking specifically about the consent decree, and I just wanted to make some very brief remarks. I understand we're going to have time for a lot of more questions and answers in another room. Isn't that correct, Claudia? You know, we'll be able to retire to another room for more questions.
215.
Yeah.
Upstairs.
And needless to say, as most of you are familiar with a very complex issue. Now I'm going to see if I can work this technology. Okay. This is the diagram that you saw. This is the diagram that you saw earlier in Bill Spencer's presentation. Bill and I have been riding the circuit now for about 3 weeks, pro and con to the consent decree. This is landfill number 3, this whole facility here, okay? Very important for you to understand that local siting approval from DeWitt County Board was granted for this whole facility in 2002. Okay, very important date. The local siting approval for that whole facility was granted in 2002 by the DeWitt County Board. Very important point, and a point made, a reference made earlier by some of the other presenters. CWU, that represents the portion that they've carved out for what you've now known, referred to as this chemical waste unit, okay? And this area has been designed to these more rigorous federal standards for a chemical waste unit. There's extra layers of HDPE liner, there's extra layers of clay. It's got more rigorous protections than a municipal solid waste landfill. The whole facility was given local siting approval as a municipal solid waste landfill by DeWitt County Board in 2002. And I think I have my year correct. The Illinois EPA then granted its permit in 2007, okay, quite a while ago. Then later on, the landfill company came in and requested a quote-unquote permit modification for this chemical waste unit. And it was their position that this was not a new pollution control facility, but rather a modification to an existing pollution control facility. Very important issue we can address more in the question and answer. I don't have much time to get into all of that. The proposed consent decree lets them leave in, as you've heard already, some manufactured gas plant waste that they already accepted in that tiny quarter there. This is the only part of the operational chemical waste unit. Can you all hear me? Mm-hmm. This is the part that you've seen pictures of, I think. And that's what's in operation now. And what the consent decree does is allow them to keep the manufactured gas plant waste that they already accepted here pursuant to that Illinois EPA approval. Okay? And it's judgment of the attorneys that there's no court in the United States that's going to order them to dig that up now for the simple reason that the permitting agency allowed them to do it. They changed their mind, and that was good. We were happy that they did that, I think in large part due to political pressure. But they did give permission for that waste to be accepted there. So it's our view that would be a waste of precious resources to continue with the litigation in the hopes that some court would order them to dig that up. It's about 1% of the capacity of the chemical waste unit, okay? Very important point. The consent decree provides that going forward, they can only put things in the area that are characterized as a chemical waste unit that they could put in a municipal solid waste landfill, that larger facility. So the consent decree essentially transforms the chemical waste unit going forward for 98 or 99% of its capacity to a municipal solid waste landfill, that larger facility, okay? We think that's a really good result. I mean, with all due respect to the opponents, that's an outcome none of us imagined we'd get to. And I have to say it's due in large part to the combination of efforts, including of the Watch people and some of the other opponents like Steve Bridges. We couldn't have gotten here without them, no doubt about it. I mentioned that in my response. They've been tireless. I've gone around East or Central Illinois with them, building the coalition. They've been terrific. and they're a big reason we're here at this point in time with this potential consent decree. So very important for you to understand that while the CWU is in fact designed to chemical waste unit standards, okay, going forward, 98-99% of its capacity, they don't get to use it as a chemical waste unit. They can only put stuff in there that they could put into a municipal solid waste landfill. So the notion that the consent decree allows a chemical waste unit to continue to operate, I just respectfully suggest is not correct. The other one point I want to make before the question and answer, because some of you, I've made this point at other public meetings, the limited nature of our lawsuit. After our attorneys looked at the record, they determined that all the Illinois EPA permit requirements had been met. The only omission that they found, so to speak, was the failure for the DeWitt County Board to approve it at a local siting hearing, the chemical waste unit. What does that mean? Well, it means if we're wildly successful with our lawsuit, and we've already been dismissed by the Pollution Control Board, what's our win? We get to go back to the DeWitt County Board. Now think about that. That's our victory if we win our lawsuit. So when you're deciding, gee, is this consent decree a good idea? We can only settle our lawsuit. We can't settle concerns about how the regulations are being implemented and all those things. We can only settle our current lawsuit. And we don't want to get back to the DeWitt County Board. A couple of the other speakers have made that point better than I could ever make. And so having said that, we'll be available for any questions. David Wentworth, our fine attorney, is here to help with that.
Okay, has Chapin Rose arrived yet? Senator Chapin Rose? No? Okay, what we're going to do is we're going to go into the Q&A session now. We'll probably take a break when Senator Rose arrives because he has a short window of time to come here and say what he needs to say, and then he's going to move on. He has something else to go to. I have the challenging task of moderating the Q&A session. So I'm going to ask that when you raise your hand to ask a question, please keep it brief. If you're making a comment, please keep it brief. Keeping it brief will allow other people to participate as well. And I think maybe some of the folks who presented should probably come up. I doubt that most of these questions will be directed to me. So other folks who helped do the presentation should probably come up and be available to provide responses. One of the other things that I'm going to request is that we start out with Q&A that is not about the consent decree. Okay, that's not to say that we can't have Q&A about that, but let's start out with Q&A that is not about the consent decree, that is about the other issues that were discussed, just so we get a chance to hear those out. Is that fair? Okay. All right, this lady right here.
Hi. First of all, I want to thank the coalition.
Coming to the mic. Oh, I'm sorry, folks. There's a mic up here. If you don't mind coming, otherwise I'll repeat your question.
Sorry, I should have pointed that out.
First of all, I want to thank the coalition for all they've done.
She's trying so hard to say really nice things at this part.
You probably already heard that, so I won't repeat.
I did hear it. She thanked the coalition for all their work. Thank you.
And as people who want to be involved, we've been getting your emails, but I understand that you are the main contact. If we have questions or how we help us go forward, you are the main contact.
Yes.
I have your email.
Oh.
I thought others might
want to. Yes. Thank you for that. Well, the healthcare consumer's email is at the bottom of the form, but I will give you my personal email. Okay, so if people want to take a note, it's all lowercase letters. It's Claudia, C-L-A-U-D-I-A, at shout, S-H-O-U-T, dot net. Claudia at shout.net. And but if you want to be added to the email list where we talk about these issues, please fill out your form and turn it in. Great. Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. I appreciate that citizen action question. Other questions? Okay, gentlemen in the middle.
I'm just wondering what kind of effect or damage we can expect from the material that's already in there. So, not to repeat this, but what are the odds of the pollution that the aquifer will be polluted by the material that's already in the sewer?
So, did people hear the question?
Could you repeat it?
So, the gentleman is asking, what are the odds that the aquifer could be affected by the material that is already in the landfill? And there's a couple folks who can come up and try to respond to that if you wish. The one thing that I would say about that, just real quick, from my experience working with the MGP site at 5th and Hill Streets in Champaign, is that it's if there is movement of contaminants through soil and groundwater, it's probably the local community that's affected first. But
one of the things they do with a groundwater monitoring system, they set up a perimeter around the facility to monitor for leaks. And Clinton Landfill has had quite a few problems with leakage already. So the sulfate readings you normally would find would be less than one in the location of the landfill, and they've had readings of 2,000. So the EPA hasn't decided to do further testing to determine the distance that the plumes move. That has to be done between the Clinton Landfill and the Illinois EPA. So there has been some problems at the facility. Like I said, Clinton Landfill 1 is in corrective action too.
Thank you, Bill. And I think that goes back to, you know, what several people have talked about, is that we need to have much more rigorous monitoring, but also transparency of that monitoring, because otherwise that can get very difficult. Thank you, Bill, for helping with that. Senator Rose is here. So how about if we take 5 minutes and hear from him? Do you need to like catch your breath or anything like that, or are you good to go? Okay, Senator Chapin Rose, thank you for being here.
First of all, thanks to everybody in this room for your continued interest in this topic. And while I know that we've had, I don't want to say success, but we've had some success here of late. Certainly the federal designation was very helpful. The governor signing the TCLIP bill was very helpful. I want to talk about a couple things that I see kind of going forward as maybe helpful. But one is that there's an ongoing issue, and let's walk away for the time being from just this particular landfill on this particular aquifer. There are landfills all over Illinois and all kinds of water supplies. And one of the questions that we continually get is, what is going into what's being accepted? And so there's a very difficult time for the public to get copies of the manifests of what's coming in and being accepted to these landfills. Oftentimes in the case of residential, there probably isn't a manifest of any type, but whatever it is, in the case of hazardous or what are called non-hazardous special waste, and these terms get very interesting and very legalistic, but you really don't know what's in the manifest. It's hard to get the manifest. So actually, I've got three bills being filed Monday. Hopefully they're back Monday. But I'm going to file three bills Monday. One would require any landfill in Illinois on any sole source designated aquifer, and I think I'm going to amend it to be any aquifer in Illinois, to publish the manifest of what's being accepted on their websites. If they're not going to put on their website, then you'd have something like a two-week period to return the information. But I think that would be very helpful for the general public, and it's been a continuing concern for people in this group. I see Bridges shaking his head here, but I also see Joe Hooker shaking his head over there. It's just been a continuing concern. So I'm going to file that on Monday. We're going to list another bill. And by the way, this goes with, you know, I know that there's parts on this agenda today talking about this particular landfill. there are landfills on this aquifer that aren't the Clinton landfill. There are landfills all over the state of Illinois. And one of the things that is that I have become increasingly concerned by is less the modern design landfills in a general term, as I am by these old pre-modern design standards, city dumps, for lack of a better phrase. And they exist everywhere. And I don't know that the state of Illinois really has a complete knowledge of where all of these are. And in many cases, I mean, I know, you know, in Charleston, if you grew up in Charleston, Illinois, you just knew the town branch was sitting on the old city dump. Well, the town branch flows into the Embraer River eventually. No one knows what's in the town branch. Now there exists to the west of Charleston now a modern design facility for the acceptance of residential waste. But nobody knows what's in that, in the old city one. And these are everywhere. Charleston is not on the Mahomet Aquifer, but obviously it flows into the Embraer. I think it is very critical for us to take a much more holistic view of the issue of water quality and not just zero in on one space, on one landfill, or on one aquifer. Because as I said, there are other landfills on this aquifer besides that one. So we're going to file that bill as well, requiring the EPA to come up with that listing. It'd be helpful if I could read my own writing on my notes here. But anyway, the cities and the counties that have joined in this effort, which is really a first of its kind effort, there is an opportunity under existing law, and if we had to change the law, we'd certainly be interested in doing that, to create a solid waste management plan for a regional plan. And I think that you could build off, again, I'm not sure this is a legislative thing because there's already statute in place, but I think the cooperative effort that's taking place here, you could build off that in the future for the creation of a regional solid waste plan. And by the way, in so doing that, you would gain enough market share that you would have some financial leverage over any particular landfill or any particular trash company. Makes sense? I think that would be very significant going forward for these communities to do that. And I, you know, and not to say that Decatur necessarily has the same objectives at the end of the day as say in Urbana, but clearly there's been some unprecedented level of cooperation here between those two communities all the way up to Bloomington and back. You could build off that in terms of a regional solid waste plan. And I think that that's something that frankly this group and other groups could build off of. Another issue, the fox guarding the hen house issue, and landfills being allowed to essentially sample their own wells. And these are licensed individuals that have professional degrees and certifications and everything else, but there's still that kind of fox guarding the hen house opportunity there. So the third bill I'm going to file on Monday would require the state EPA to separately sample at least 6 times a year at random times and random wells, whatever collections are being made at any landfill on top of a sole source aquifer. Now, again, I think it's nice to have that designation now, right? So we can start getting away from, and one of the things you have in the state constitution, and this is a trick for legislators and the public alike, is you have, you can't create legislation that targets a single entity. So you can't specify one entity. You can do things generally speaking. So if you're a sole source aquifer, and that would apply to any landfill on top of a sole source aquifer, you can pass those types of bills. So one of the things that, again, and we're actually in our Mahomet Aquifer working group that met up until Pat Quinn canceled it, right before he issued the permit to accept waste at the landfill. One of the things that kept coming up at that meeting time and again was the notion of, you know, the fox guarding the hen house. We were able to get the state EPA to go out and take some additional samples. Actually, those samples did match what had been turned in largely, so there wasn't much of an issue there. But I think it's important that we continue that. And if you do it randomly, it sort of removes any motive or opportunity for anyone to cheat on the margins. So I'm going to file that as well. The last thing I would say to y'all, and I'm really interested to see what this group comes up with in terms of the coal ash issue and the scientific basis behind that, because current EPA regs do allow coal ash as some soil amendments already, and that's state regs and federal regs for that matter. So I'm interested in what this group has to say about that in its final. But one of the things that has been nice in the last 8 months, as I told you a minute ago, EPA walked away from the working group back in July or August of last year of 14. Fast forward to January of this year, same EPA, different governor met in my office with Representative Ammons and Senator Bennett, and Claudia was there, and actually started coming up with some I thought thoughtful conversation and dialogue on how to move forward. And actually that's what ultimately became the TCLIP, the amendment to the Ammons bill and the Bennett bill. The TCLIP test was actually negotiated in my office out here on Staley Road. And so it is actually nice to have an EPA that is somewhat back in the game, even though I think everybody's still somewhat suspicious of their past actions. It was nice in January this year to have them finally wanting to participate again. So last thing I'm going to say is I'm going to restart the working group once again here, now that we've got a little bit more cooperative EPA again. I mean, I was stunned when they walked away last August, whatever it was, July or August, Bill, you'd know, I don't remember, July. But we're going to restart that. So that's kind of the update from my end. I appreciate everybody in this room. We've been running around this morning, and I got three more meetings yet today, and then hopefully I'll see my kids at some point. So anyway, see you later.
Thank you, Senator Rose, and I hope that his presentation helps to underscore the need for people to be involved, because as he is bringing legislation forward, we're going to need people power to help get those support forms submitted at committee hearings and so on. Okay, let's go back to Q&A. Other people with questions? Okay, David.
This is a question for our attorneys. I'm trying to figure out how it is possible for the IEPA to regulate and say that Clinton Landfill could bring in high levels of MGP waste because they're illegal under federal law. Even for hazardous landfills, if you bring in high levels of MGP waste or hazardous landfill, they can't put it in the ground because it has high levels of benzene or the other VTEX components. It has to be remediated before it actually goes into the ground, because everyone knows that these affect the liners. If you look at the federal code, it says here's the maximum level you can have for benzene, here's the maximum level you can have for toluene, for ethyl benzene, and for xylene, and you can't go above those. So I don't see how the IEPA could say you can violate federal law by bringing in waste that have higher than those allowed levels.
I'm not going to repeat that question. I know some of you were not able to hear. I won't repeat the whole thing, but the gist of it is how could the Illinois EPA allow in the first place the highly toxic MGP waste from going in, because David maintains that there's federal law prohibiting that, and he's asking the question to Joe. Joe, do you have a response? Oh, okay, come on up.
Well, my response is very simple. I don't know.
Okay.
Do you accept the premise?
Was somebody saying something?
I just wanted to know if you accept the premise that these things are going to deteriorate the 1,000-year protection layer.
You know, that's an issue that we've been paying attention to. There's a lot of scientific, there's back and forth on it from both sides. I don't know if you want to say something else.
Yeah, let me just very briefly respond to that, and by first saying it's not in our lawsuit. The Illinois EPA did not do anything improper when they authorized these liners. There's a few studies out there that show that if high enough concentrations that it has some effect on these liners. There's other studies that say it's not a problem because of the concentrations of these chemicals would never be high enough in the manufactured source material. So it's one of these back and forth type of things. There's lots of redundancies in this chemical waste unit. There's no simple answer to that, but the bottom line is we don't have any ability with our lawsuit to change that, and I can't emphasize that enough. So the notion that we would reject this consent decree because there's some controversy about, you know, how long these liners can protect or be resistant to this doesn't make sense to me. I mean, from an attorney standpoint, and basically we could spend a lot more money, and it's not even part of our complaint. Again, it's a procedural omission that's our lawsuit. So when you're talking about how does this affect the consent decree, not at all, as far as what a reasonable consent decree or settlement of our lawsuit would be.
Are there other questions? You'll be next, Ashley.
I'm Terry Hoffman, and I'm from DeWitt County. I am on the county board, and I'm the one that's opposing the hazardous waste going in. That's not my questions. I'm just kind of giving a background of who I am. I am 2 miles from the landfill. My family has had a well in the aquifer since 1960, so that's several years. But my question, we've heard two representatives come up here. We need more legislation. More legislation so we can have more laws so that we can watch what's going on here. Steve brought that up also. Joe's brought that up. Our consent decree has brought that up. We already have our laws in place. Every law that we have in place now is what they're wanting to expand on. We had a siting that was supposed to be held before the people of the county of DeWitt County. Whether it goes back to the board or not, it was to go to the county first, to the people. So we've got the laws in place. So question to Steve and Joe and whoever else. We've got our laws. How are we going to enforce the laws that we have and quit making new laws that are redundant to what we already have and we're not following? Why don't we enforce what we already have? You can answer that now, or I've got a second question I can sit down.
Go ahead, Tears.
My second one, the consent decree is basically pushing to the landfill. They're going to monitor the landfill for life. You just brought up we're going to boycott area landfill. If we boycott them, who in the hell is going to pay for this watching after the landfill and our leaking? So my question is, we're going to boycott them, but who's going to pay for it then, and who's going to do the inspections if we break this company? Which, I mean, I understand our reasoning for it, but now we're wanting to push it off to them to keep inspecting for us, and then we're also going to push this to the EPA to inspect for us. The EPA has already proved to us they're not following the laws either, because they had a fraudulent report to give them a permit to do this. So I guess in my whole thing of it, and I'm sorry I'm taking so long, but this is a big issue. So there's my two questions, I guess. We've already got everything in before us, our laws. Why can we not follow what laws we have now? And instead of our lawyers backing down now and saying this is not winnable, it's going to push it back to the DeWitt County Board, fight this son of a gun. 90% of the people say, fight it. We do not want a toxic waste. So lawyers, why are we quitting on this? And that's what it is. Are you scared of something? Are you do not have the power of it? And I know, okay. I shake your head.
Terry.
And I'm sorry. Thank you.
Thank
Bye.
Thank you, Terry. Can I just address the boycott issue first, and then Joe, Dave, if y'all want to respond. I guess just a couple comments real quick. Regarding the boycott, wow, if we could really organize a boycott that would actually really threaten Clinton Landfill's viability, that would be a fun problem to have and then figure out from there on. It's the idea of the boycott is, if we want to do it, we'll get together and talk about it. This, we're just introducing the idea at this meeting, but there would be an organizing effort to help, you know, make the public aware of the issues. One of the other things that I just wanted to comment on regarding the issue of the laws, I respectfully, you know, disagree in terms of, do we have all the laws in place that we need? We heard from Tyler Rotchke about one particular type of waste, just one particular type, and there are more that is consciously unregulated from a layperson's perspective. The US EPA has chosen not to regulate it in a certain way. The Illinois EPA has chosen not to regulate it in a certain way. That kind of waste can go into any kind of landfill. And just as a reminder, MGP waste, prior to the bill that just got signed by the governor, sponsored by Senator Bennett and Representative Ammons, prior to that, technically, MGP waste could have gone into any landfill in the state of Illinois, any municipal waste landfill, until that law got passed.
Not the source material.
So this gets complicated, and it's technical, and it's difficult. But a lot of us do believe that the regulations that are in place are inadequate. Legislation is inadequate. And then just from the big picture, the state of Illinois is very far behind on environmental regulations and laws compared to other states in the country. That's just my piece that I'm saying. I don't know if Joe or Dave, if y'all wanted to comment or respond or save it for afterwards, because we're going to be running short on time right now. Okay. So just as a reminder, people are not obligated to do this. It's not a formal part of this meeting, but as soon as we wrap up here in just a few minutes, folks can actually go upstairs to room 215. Stuart Levy will, he's right here. He'll lead you up there, and then people can continue to have more discussion and more dialogue if you want. There's no agenda. It's not sponsored by anybody. It's just we decided it would be better than having crowds in the hallway here when there's going to be another event in this room. So more discussion can happen there, I think. If there is one last simple question, I'll take that, and then I'm going to turn it over to Walt to wrap us up. Is it simple? Come on. Or you can shout it, and I'll repeat it.
Okay. When Mr. Hooker and Mr. Wentworth and I think Mr. Marilyn came before the county board, he brought up the consent decree. I asked, there are two things in there that say that the landfill will not accept MGP until it has fulfilled all the conditions of its permits and contracts, and then a similar one for PCBs. And I asked why that was in there when they were supposed never to accept those things again. And they said, well, a lot of people had a hand in that, and that was just left over. But when I called the lawyer the next day, I was told that when you have clauses in a contract that disagree, they are both equally valid. So we do not truly have their promise never to accept more MGP.
Okay, so that's an interpretation. Do you want to speak to that or wait till afterwards? If you want to speak to it, can you do it in 2 minutes?
The short answer is that clause does not control. The clause that does control is the one where they promise never ever to either request permission to accept the waste or to accept that waste.
Then why are the other okay. clauses
if the, those right. other clauses don't directly address that, they deal
then
with
why
another.
Are they there?
Okay. Well, okay, you know what? I'm gonna use my moderator's prerogative at this point in time, folks, because we are gonna need to wrap up and get out of the room. We have one last speaker who is just closing us up. This is Walt Wessel. He's out here from Decatur, and he is part of Illinois People's Action. Thank you, Walt.
Thanks, buddy. Well, I hope you all took really good notes, because this will all be on the quiz after the meeting here. It's a complicated issue, folks. We know that. But I know this. I retired, and I thought I'd have a nice, easy retirement until this issue came along, because guess what? We get our water directly out of the Mahomet Aquifer. And guess what? I have a great-grandchild who most likely will also be getting her water out of the aquifer. So I'm involved, and my point is only this. If you're not involved yet, get involved. It's easy. You can call the governor anytime. Sign up on this sheet. When you call your legislators or governor, whoever, you're going to talk to their aide anyway, so you aren't going to talk to them. But I also want to thank very much, first of all, I hope all of us will thank all of the presenters that were here today. They did a wonderful job, as usual. Give yourself a hand for taking a beautiful day like this and spending it talking about a very complicated issue. So congratulations to you. So just a couple of housekeeping things. It was mentioned earlier that Representative Ammons is going to have a meeting on September 22nd. That's this Tuesday. It's going to be here in this room. It'll start at 5:30, and they're going to be talking about the issue of coal ash, which we've already discussed a little bit. And guess what's next for Clinton? Clinton will be accepting coal ash. So we want to go and do that. But I just want to emphasize again, write a letter, write an editorial, phone calls, petitions. Our church in Decatur alone had 500 signatures on a petition that we sent to the US EPA to make this a sole source aquifer. That was part of our response. It can be part of your response. You can speak truth to power anytime. So that's, I believe, everything. And thank you very much for coming.